Hi there, everybody, and a very pleasant good evening to you, wherever you may be. It's time for Dodger Baseball Chronicles. My name is Peter Trunk. My two co-hosts are Ron Rabinowitz and Robert Cole. Tonight, we have two special guests. We're going to talk about the 2020 World Champion Los Angeles Dodgers, how and why and everything in between. We have Linda Wilson from California, and we have Bernie Rose from Florida, both gigantic Dodger fans all their lives. And I want to welcome them to the show. Hello, Linda. Hello, Bernie.
Hey.
Hello. Good evening.
How you doing?
Good. Now,
welcome to the show.
I want to know. Here's what we want to know. Ronnie wants to know it. Robert wants to know it. And I want to know it. Why did it take the Dodgers so long to win the World Series? And we know that the elephant in the room is the banging on the garbage cans and all that stuff. But let's leave ladies first. Linda Wilson from California, big Dodger fan for many, many, many years, all of her life. Linda, how are you, dear? And welcome to the show. And start us off.
Okay, well, I'm doing really well, thank you. I had a feeling this year when it was announced that the opening day or the season itself was going to be delayed. I had a feeling that we might not even have a season at all. And I was kind of surprised when they said they would come back in July, at the end of July, and start with a 60-game season. And I said, well, great. Wouldn't it be that this would be the year that the Dodgers are going to figure out how to do it, and then the Giants fans will all tell us, oh, it's not full season, so it doesn't count. Well, that's what happened. That's why it happened, because it had to be controversial. But seven years prior to this year, they were in the playoffs and got the experience. And I told my younger Dodger fan friends who weren't alive in 1988, I said, look, you guys are feeling what it was like to be a Brooklyn Dodger fan before 1955. You just had heartbreak, heartbreak, heartbreak. So they now know the joy of that, winning that championship. And just like the Brooklyn fans knew in 1955, they finally got over the hump. So this is our turn. This is a new generation's
good point.
Turn.
Good point, Linda. Besides Mookie Betts, who's obvious.
Yeah.
Why did the Dodgers win? Why did they finally get over the hump? Are there underlying, everybody's saying Mookie Betts. It's starting to get a little bit boring. He is a wonderful, wonderful ball player. He's super. But why did they finally get over, Linda? And then we'll go.
Well, I think part of it has to do with the fact that Clayton Kershaw had a good postseason, or at least he was 4-1 in the postseason. And that's a huge step, because we all know Kershaw's woes historically in the playoffs. Yeah. So the fact that Kershaw and Buehler were so ready and effective in the World Series is huge. It's not just Mookie Betts, just the fact that the pitching was on the same page finally. Julio Urias came through when, earlier in the season, we didn't know what his role was going to be, where he was going to be at the end of the season. And here he was at the end of the very last game, getting the last out.
Yeah.
So all those things combined to get the championship. And, it's like I said, again, going back to the 1955 Brooklyn Dodgers, like, what did it take? It took Johnny Podres to come through at the end. And Johnny Podres came through in the end, and he made the difference that year. And then turns out 1981, the Dodgers had, a few teams in the 70s that went to the World Series and didn't win it, and the difference was Fernando. Okay, well, this time I'm going to say the difference was the pitching staff just in general, okay? It wasn't just any one, but they all got it together at the same time.
Right, I agree. Yeah.
Okay, Bernie Rose.
Absolutely.
How are you, Bernie? Welcome to the show. Tell us what you think.
Well, she hit a lot of points I was going to say. The bullpen, top to bottom, this year was the best they've had in quite some time.
Right.
Don't you think? Top to bottom. And the thing with Kershaw, I'd like to point out, if you go back to that St. Louis series, they didn't have to leave him in. They could have beaten St. Louis. You go back just to last year, after he came in and got that guy out in relief, that's it. You're done. You take him out. Kershaw beat St. Louis in the first game. Kershaw beat Washington in the first game. And a couple of moves that Roberts could have made back then, and it might not have been such a long wait. And Corey Seager was on his game the whole season, the whole playoffs. And, you know, we get into the health problems and other things. And Dave Roberts making the right moves and the guys performing for him in a lot of those things did not happen in some of these last few years.
Oh, they didn't.
Never thought I would agree with that part. But I did.
But case in point, he talked, you know, May and Gonsolin, the scene, I kept saying it, the stage is too big for these guys. I know they're good. I know they're rookies. I know the rookies are performing or have performed. But it just seemed like the first two times both came out in that World Series, they were having trouble. And luckily, they didn't have to stay in very long. But Roberts talked to May, and he came in, and he took Kershaw out at just the right time. And May was perfect, and so were the two guys after him. And they won that fifth game. And Roberts played it perfect. And Roberts played it perfect in game six. And those guys went 7 1/3 innings of zero run, two-hit baseball with that bullpen. The Dodgers' bullpen was better than Tampa's bullpen, but it was Tampa's bullpen that was being lauded as the best bullpen. But I knew that wasn't true, and they proved it. The Dodgers were better top to bottom than Tampa Bay. Tampa Bay couldn't hit. They couldn't hold a candle to the Dodgers at hitting.
No.
And
let's touch on something that if we don't touch on it, it would be a disgrace. We have to touch on, I'm going to jump back to Linda for this, and then I'll come back to Bernie again. Let's jump to the young man who happens to be the manager of the Tampa Bay Rays.
Oh!
I, among a lot of other people online, among a lot of other people, made snide remarks. In fact, I wrote on my Facebook page, the Dodgers should vote him a full share of the World Series when he took the pitcher out. What are your feelings about that, Linda? Because I know my feelings. I know my feelings.
Well,
and Robert and Ronnie know my feelings because I've told them off the air what my feelings are about that, Kevin taking out his star pitcher. Go ahead. What do you think?
Well, I mean, I agree with you, but at the same time, that could have been Dave Roberts any one of the last few years. I mean, if you remember 2 years ago when he took out Rich Hill at a fairly low pitch count and the Dodgers were ahead and had the chance to tie up the series at 2 games each that night and the bullpen gave it up and that turned the whole series. So everybody pointed the finger at Roberts. Now, this time it's Kevin Cash's turn to get his finger pointed. But that's the way they manage these days. We know that. And it's not, you know, it's not just one team that does it that way. Most of them do it that way. And they, you know, they rely on what got them there. And that's what got them there. That, you know, they exactly. take the chance that that's going to work.
Exactly. Bernie, what do you think?
Well, you know, we all felt the same way. This guy was blowing them away. He was looking great. But here you are in a game that there were not many runs going to be scored anyway. And what was he going to stay in another inning or two? My feeling is the Dodgers could have caught up to these guys and won that game anyway. He would have had to have gone 9, and I don't think that was going to happen.
All right, I want to let one of my partners in on this because he's a Tampa Tampa fan. Robert, what do you think about Kevin Cash taking him out?
Well, I had to call up my cable company the next day to get a new cable converter because I threw it up against the wall. Okay. However, okay, having watched Kevin Cash for the last 5 years, okay, this is what he does, and he does it every single game. Okay. The only thing that I question is in the first game, okay, he did not take his starter out. He let him pitch 110 pitches, okay? Should have taken him out, and he would have been more rested for his next start. So that was the question that I have, okay? I think he mismanaged that. But as far as taking Snell out, that's what he does, okay?
My contention was always, and Bernie and Linda, you're hearing this for the first time, but Ronnie and Robert have heard this ad infinitum from me. Here's a guy, Kevin Cash, who did this all season long. Now, Robert just said for 5 years. I'm just going to keep it for this year. He did it for the whole 60-game schedule. That's the way he managed. And he won 40 games, more than any other American League team. So if he was to go out and talk to the kid and leave him in the game, and then he would get lit up and the Dodgers would win, he would have been fired.
Right.
Because he would have broken, exactly, he would have broken the rule or the unwritten rule of how he managed, as Robert said, for the last 5 years, but I'll keep it just this season. He did that for all 60 games. Yeah. And he was very, very successful. He had the best record in the American League. So how can anybody fault him for continuing to do what he did all summer long? And the only thing a Dodger fan can look at it with a little smirk on his face, like Bernie and I, when we message each other back and forth, say, well, thank God he's an idiot. But he really isn't an idiot. What he did was he stayed true to his plan that he had all year and that worked for him all year. He stayed true to his plan. I'm sure if he had it to do over again, he would have left them in. Just like
No, he wouldn't have.
Okay, you know what? Well,
he wouldn't have.
That even proves my point better.
Well, there you go. The thing is that he and the whole organization believed in that bullpen. They did, and that was their thing. That was their go-to. Although it was just a single, the guy was pitching for that, and it was only the second single and hit he gave up in the whole game.
It was not that hit, okay? He does not allow Snell or most of his starters to go a third time through the order. That was the ninth hitter, okay? That was the 27th batter.
Right.
And that's why he took him out. It wasn't the single, okay? He probably would have taken him out even if he had gotten him out.
You know what? I'm going to tell you something. Robert may be right because, well, if you look at the statistics, and I know you're going to roll your eyes, you're going to say, I'm not that kind of a fan, I don't believe in that stuff. But if you look at the statistics of a pitcher like that, the first time through a lineup, the second time through a lineup, and God forbid, the third time through a lineup, it's like night and day.
Night and day.
Like night and day. It's like the first time through a lineup, the guys are hitting 111 against them. The second time through the lineup, they're hitting 175 against them. The third time, they're hitting 350.
Yeah.
And if I could
so
add.
So the stats back that up.
Right.
Yeah.
The stats back up what he did.
Right.
To a baseball fan, especially a baseball fan of a certain age, that was all wrong and it was not the right thing to do. But anyway, that's what happened. That's what did it. Blah, blah, blah.
You're right. Now, and, you know, there's another reason why.
Go ahead, Brian.
I added on top of that, the Dodgers were the best team in the league in that department. Third time around, if they hadn't got you, they're going to get you.
Yeah, that's seventh inning on, the Dodgers were best in baseball.
Yeah, they were.
Stats. I know that's true. Listen, I don't want to give you guys up so fast because I don't know how quickly you're going to make a comeback and come back on the show. While I have you here, I need to delve more. I need to ask more questions. There's two rumors that are going around on the East Coast. I don't know about Florida. I don't know about California. The two buzzwords on the East Coast here are, and not in necessarily this order, the third baseman from the Colorado Rockies.
I've heard it.
And the shortstop.
Nolan Arenado.
Arenado and Francisco Lindor. Those are two rumors that are flying around here that involve the Dodgers. Linda, have you heard anything? Do you hear any whispers or anything out in California?
I hear the same things you do. And let's face it, even though we're on different coasts, we still have the same internet and we still have the same websites. So I hear the same things. I don't really think that the Dodgers can pay everybody that they need to. Like, they've got a lockup on Seager and Walker Buehler after this year. So I'm not sure that they're willing. I don't know that they can take on Nolan Arenado.
All these things sound great.
All of these moves, the proposed moves, they all sound great. Everybody has them every offseason, and sometimes they happen, but rarely. I think more than often than not, they don't. But what were you going to ask?
How stuck are you? And I'm not talking about if you like him or not, because I know you love him. But how stuck are you business-wise on Justin Turner?
He's
a free agent.
Yeah.
Do you offer him 2 years at a reasonable amount, or do you go crazy and offer him 4 years? The guy's 36.
No, not at his age. You don't go crazy. Yeah, you offer him a short-term contract, and then – If it's not in the cards, it's not in the cards. But I'm just glad that he was with the team long enough to win a championship.
Right.
Otherwise,
Bernie,
I would have.
Bernie, what do you think about that, Bernie?
Yeah, I think he'd sign for 2 years. He's going to be 36 when the season starts. 36 and 37. How can you give him a 4 year till he's 39?
Oh, you can't.
You can't. And he, if he wants to stay, what I didn't know until yesterday was that Arenado was an L.A. guy also, like Turner. I didn't know that.
And that. Oh, Arenado, yeah.
Yeah. But $35 million a year, another one? How many guys are you going to pay $35 million a year?
No, the thing is this. Turner never made his money because he only became a star at age 30. He never made all of that money that he could have made if he became a star at 25.
Yeah.
Well, unfortunately for him, the last year of his contract this year, he was going to get $20 million. But COVID came, and he got prorated down probably to under 10, you know, which is chump change.
How can a poor guy make it on $10 million a year?
Yeah,
It's a damn shame. If I were to guess – and I'm not making any predictions, but a guess. If somebody pushed me for a guess, I would say Lindor goes to the Mets and Arenado goes to the Dodgers.
No, they're not. The Mets are not going to make a trade for Lindor.
If they can tie him up for 10 years?
He's already said that he's going to go free agent.
Okay. Well, that's what Mookie Betts said, too.
Okay, well, but the Dodgers are going to be out there. The Yankees are going to be out there. The Mets are going to be out there, okay? Several teams are going to be out there that have money, all right? He'd be foolish at this point to go any further than 1 year, all right? This is, you know, you go through this year, and if fans come back into the stadiums and stuff, okay, he can basically ask for what he wants next year.
Well, then I don't want any of my teams that I follow trading for him. I don't want him for 1 year. That's like a Manny Machado bullshit. You know, who cares one season? I don't want him for one season. I don't want to give up
right.
good young ball players.
Exactly.
I have him for 1 year.
Exactly.
I don't want to do that.
That's why you let it go this year, He's going to be a free agent. You make your pitch next year. Okay. You know, as far as the Mets go, they'll have the money next year like they have this year.
But see, so, Cleveland can't just let him go.
No.
Cleveland has to trade him.
No, they'll get killed.
If you could get him on the cheap, quote unquote cheap, even if it's for 1 year, wouldn't you do it?
The reason, no. He's not going to come, Peter, he's not going to come cheap. Okay?
For 1 year, he's going to come cheap.
No, he's not. No, he's not. Not as far as the Mets go. Okay, there's guys on the Mets that Cleveland wants. Okay? They're going to want, you know, Jimenez, the young shortstop. They're going to want an outfielder. They're going to want two prospects. They've already said that. Now, I would trade Jimenez straight up for Lindor. Okay.
They won't do it.
Okay, but Cleveland's not going to do that.
No, they won't do it.
I like Jimenez. I don't want him to go. I like him a lot. But anyway, let's not talk about the Mets. It's a Dodger show.
I'm sorry.
So Dave Roberts.
You know something? That.
So Dave Roberts did not win Manager of the Year. he did.
But Kevin Price did.
Who? Friedman did. Executive of the Year.
Yeah.
Kevin Cash won, though.
Yeah, okay. But in the National League we're talking about.
No. Jim Mattingly, the former Dodger manager, won it.
Which, to me, I'm telling you, that was joke. Crazy. Jace Tingler should have won it with the Padres.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Mattingly doesn't even make the playoffs if it's a full season with that team.
Right.
You know, they expanded the playoffs, so he got in.
Right.
He played okay, right.
Padres are a great team, though.
Padres were unbelievable.
Padres
were great. And living here in San Diego, I saw a lot of them when they weren't playing the Dodgers. They are on the way up. And
there's no doubt about it.
Dodgers better be ready.
Well, they got to make the right moves. You know, if I could go back to the initial question from the beginning, I'd like to touch on a point.
Go right ahead.
Because there's a couple of things that happened in some of these playoffs over these last 7 years or so. Like when Seager came up in that series against the Mets, that five-game series that the Dodgers should have won, and you guys followed that series being Dodgers and Mets fans, when Corey Seager did not cover third base.
Right.
In that Rookie game, if he does, the Dodgers win that game. And maybe they win the whole thing after that. Last year, if Seager would have just got two hits in that Washington series at a couple of different at-bats, the Dodgers win that series. Seager was not totally healthy. I don't want to rag on him, but he had a horrible series. There were men all over the bases. If he hit like he did this year, they would have swept Washington last year, and they win the World Series. And then he comes back, and he has a whole playoffs for the ages.
Yeah.
He came to play.
He did. He was terrific.
Right. He was healthy.
He carried that team.
He did. And you know, when they lost that game 8-7, they never should have lost that game. Turner and Seager went 4-for-5. That game should have been over.
Yeah.
And yet, what did they do? That would have been the perfect time for the Dodgers to collapse after losing that game, and it'd be 2-2. And what did they do? They only gave up, you know, two runs in the next two games or something, and that was it.
After they won game five, I felt really good, because if they could bounce back from that and look good the next night, they looked pretty confident. I felt like they're going to win this thing. But they
absolutely.
Just
and I don't want to diminish Kershaw's postseason as well.
Right.
And
yeah, it was great.
He was there.
But
he had plenty of good games. Some of those games that he blew – he should have been taken out of.
Yeah.
And it might not have been so bad. But he was phenomenal.
Plus, Bernie, one or two of those games were the garbage can games, weren't they?
Yeah.
Cheating games where they knew what was coming.
Yep.
Yeah, because that first game against the Astros, he shut them down. Yeah. And in that sixth game, well, his next start against the Astros, you're 100% right. Without the cheating, they win that game. Yeah, and they win the series in six.
That's right.
So he was victimized there as well.
Yeah. Okay, my producer tells me we have 8 minutes to go. Let's touch on this, even though it's so, so early. It's not even Thanksgiving. But can the Dodgers repeat?
Yes.
Why not?
Ronnie, how do you like that? As soon as I asked the question, Linda said yes.
Yes.
What do you think, Ronnie?
I think so. I think, though, they're going to need some help from Corey and Muncy. They had a lousy year, both of them.
Yeah.
And they did not play their potential.
Are you talking about Cody?
Cody Bellinger, he meant.
Yeah.
I think.
Cody and Muncy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you know what? Muncy, he came alive in that World Series.
Yeah.
Yes, he did.
And he even had a terrible season. Braves, all those walks and a couple of key hits. He had a horrible season.
You know why I can't get mad at Muncy ever?
No.
Because he never stops hustling.
Right.
Well, you know.
Bellinger does. Bellinger hits a ground ball at second base. He starts walking.
Yeah.
Muncy runs like Utley.
Yes.
Like Utley. Yeah. Like his life depended on it.
He does.
I love that hustle.
I'll say this to you. I agree with you completely about that. That's a great point about him, and I've always liked that about him. But I can't ever be mad at Muncy because of the fact that in Game 3 of the World Series 2018, I was standing there at Dodger Stadium for 6.5 hours, and he ended the game.
Think
about David Price next year.
Yeah, that'll be interesting.
You got good memories there.
Let's
not forget about Mookie this year. Mookie, we haven't talked about him.
Well, you want to know something? He's too obvious to talk about because he's so great. He steals bases. He makes throws from the right field corner.
He
cuts balls off with his glove. He slides around tags.
Yeah.
He works the count. He does this. He does that. He does so many things, and he does them all so well.
Yeah. He saves more runs in right field than any other right fielder in the game by far.
He's unbelievable.
Yes.
Yeah, the Globetrotters are going to love him.
And Julio, straight outs against the Braves, 7 straight outs in the World Series to close it down.
Yes.
Gotta hand it to him. We got 5 minutes left. Let's talk about.
What about Kenley?
Kenley Jansen. Let's talk about him. Linda, tell us about him. What do we do with him?
I that's been the big quandary for me, and I really am not sure what to do about him. I've been kind of agonizing about how this is going to play out, and I wonder what you guys think about that.
Well, one dimension deeper than Turner. Turner, I worry about because I love the guy, and he's a Dodger, and he's in my heart and everything. But Kenley, it's almost to the point where is he going to be able to live and survive to an old man, or is his baseball career cutting down his lifespan because of his heart issue? Issues, plural. God forbid he dies at like 44 or something like that. Oh my God. It really would kill me. But as strictly baseball, without worrying about heart trouble and et cetera like that, what do you think, Bernie, about moving forward Kenley Jansen? Strictly baseball. Forget his physical ailment.
I don't know that he's going to be able to get the job done anymore. You know, is pitchers are slowing down, you know, over year by year. And if he can get the, you know, the speed back up, they've got him, what, only one more year anyway, right? Yeah, so
at least one more year, maybe two.
So, I mean, he's going to be on the team. You got to see what he's going to do. What I'd like to get from the rest of you guys is, you know, there's a lot of free agents in the bullpen, and all these fill-in guys, Hernandez and Peterson, and training's gone. And, I mean, who are we bringing back? Who are we going to replace them with if we don't?
Well, I have another question. I same church, different pew. Why was Hand let go?
Money.
$6 million? That's money?
Cleveland, it is.
$6 million?
To Cleveland, it is. Cleveland is cleaning house. They're getting rid of payroll.
Somebody's got to pick up that guy.
Oh, they will. But he wants a free agent contract.
I mean, he's got his whip. His whip is like under one.
Yes.
And his ERA is under two. He's unreal. He's an incredible ball player. The only thing is, I did read that his numbers were going the other way. In other words, his percentage of balls hit hard against him was going up. His strikeouts per nine innings was going down. His fastball velocity was slowing down, even though he had a hell of a year in 2020. A hell of a year. All the stats are going the wrong way on him.
Be that as it may,
who are the Dodgers going to lose from their bullpen? Bernie?
Well, Trainin's a free agent.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let him go.
Let him go, really?
Yeah.
Geez, I'd love to see him back.
I didn't like him.
I like him.
No, I liked him a lot.
I liked him.
Unless you think Gratterall's going to become the closer.
Well, no.
You know what? He's a little wacky, that guy. He's a little wacky. He's throwing his glove up in the air, kicking his hat, jumping up and down just because he got the third out of the inning. There's something wrong with him.
Yeah. He's a young guy. He's a young...
Yeah, but that's Bernie, seriously. If he tried that with the old New York Mets, John Franco would have grabbed him by his throat.
I know.
Yeah, but he's the modern day Russ Meyer.
Yeah.
The mad monk, number 34, Russ Meyer. Okay, listen, we got less than a minute. My man over here in the booth is telling me we gotta go. I wanna thank Linda Wilson from San Diego, California. Mm-hmm. I wanna thank Bernie Rose from Florida. I don't know what town you live in, or else I would say it.
I'm in South Florida, Boynton Beach.
All right, South Florida, Martin Beach. My good friend, Robert Cole. My other good friend and partner, Ron Rabinowitz. And my name is Peter Trunk. Thank you for watching, and good night. Yeah.